We are going to look at the time delay for various 8051 chips. So that is what we are going to look at. And the first part of it that we are going to look at is the machine cycle for 8051. Machine cycle for 8051 microcontrollers. Machine cycle for 8051 microcontrollers. That is the first thing that we're going to look at. Then when you talk about the machine cycle for the 8051, you'll realize that the CPU usually take a number of clock cycles in order to execute an instruction. In the 8051 family, the clock cycles as such are always referred to as the machine cycles. They're always referred to as the machine cycles. And the instruction list of 8051, usually, if you go to the instruction set of 8051 microcontrollers, you will find it usually has the machine cycles and also the instructions. So each and every instruction usually has the number of machine cycles that it has. And in order to calculate this, the time delay, we usually use the instruction sets with the details that are provided in them. And in the 8051 family, the length of the machine cycles usually depends on the frequency of the crystal oscillator that is connected to the system. You remember from the block diagram of the microcontroller, there was the oscillator circuit. So it is this oscillator circuit frequency that will always determine the machine cycle of the system. The crystal oscillator, along with the on-chip circuitry, usually provide a clock source for the 8051 CPU. And the frequency of the crystal that is connected to the 8051 family usually vary from 4 megahertz, usually vary from 4 megahertz to 24 megahertz, not 24, but to 30 megahertz. Usually vary from that, and this one usually depends on the chip rating of the manufacturer. It usually depends on the chip rating and the manufacturer. And in most cases, the frequency that is often used is the 11.0592 megahertz. That is the frequency of the crystal oscillator that is always used. And this one is usually done in order to make the 8051 system to be compatible with the serial port of the IBM PC. That is the IBM, the computers that are made by the IBM, because that is a major manufacturer of computers. So in the original 8051, one machine cycle usually last for 12 oscillator periods. In the original 8051 microcontroller, one machine cycle lasts for 12 oscillator periods. And therefore, when you are calculating the machine cycle for 8051, we usually take 1 over 12 of the crystal frequency, then take its reverse in order to obtain the machine cycle. Because we calculate the machine cycle, we usually calculate it in terms of time. We usually get it in terms of time. So, and we know the relationship between the frequency and time, which is 1 over F is equals to T. So that is what usually give us how we can always get the machine cycle of a particular system. So we can look at an example on this and... We can look at an example on how to get the machine cycle, and then from there we can proceed. Do I need to write the example? So, watch out. Example one. The following. Shows crystal frequency. shows crystal frequency for three different, for three different 8051 based systems. Find the period of the machine cycle in each case. Find the period of the machine cycle in each case. Find the period of the machine cycle in each case. So A, we have 11.0592 megahertz. B, we have 16 megahertz. And C, we have 20 megahertz. 20 megahertz. So we can start by looking at the first one, whereby we can look at A so that we can obtain the number of the what we call the period of the machine cycle. The period of the machine cycle. So the first thing that we said is that that particular crystal frequency that you are given, you're supposed to divide it by 12. So, and then get its reciprocal. And that one is what is going to give you the machine cycle. So it's not a very difficult calculation. So we can start by saying, we can say A, for A, we have 11.0592. So 11.0592, we are going to multiply by 1 over 12 or by, or simply divide by 12. The reason why we do that is because we say that one machine cycle usually lasts 12 oscillator periods. So it means that that particular frequency will give you, the total frequency that will be given is 12 oscillator periods. So we have to divide by 12 so that we can obtain a single oscillator period. So that one is going to give us, if you divide properly, then you are going to have 921 kilohertz. And therefore, now you have that. And then from the relationship of 1 over f, t is equals to 1 over f, we are going to get the reciprocal of that in order to obtain the machine cycle. Therefore, machine cycle is going to be 1 all over 921 kilohertz, which is simply going to give us 1.085 microseconds. You should always ensure that you take care of the units. Ensure that you take care of the units. Like this one is mega. Maybe if you do it properly, then you can say that this one is now going to be 11.0592 times 10 raised to power 6. Then you get that. If you divide it by 12, then you are going to get 921 123 kilohertz. So that one is hertz. Then if you divide the reciprocal of that, 1 all over 921 123 hertz, is going to give us 1.085 seconds. So that is what you are supposed to do. It's just a very, very simple calculation that you are supposed to do that with. The same is for part B, which is 16 megahertz. When you talk of the 16 megahertz, for the 16 megahertz, we are going to look at, let's talk of the 16 megahertz. So one thing that you need to do is to ensure that you take care of the units. If it is mega, you can always put them to hertz. So for the consistency, so that when you put them to hertz, then you'll easily get it in the get your answer in seconds, and so on and so forth. So ensure that you take care of the units. The second part is 16 megahertz. 16 megahertz, that is part B, 16 megahertz. So the other one, so 16 megahertz is going to be, if we convert it to hertz, 16 times 10 raised to power 6, which is now hertz. Then we divide that one by 12 because of the 12 oscillator periods that we had talked about earlier. So if you divide that one by 6, then we are going to obtain we are going to obtain something like 1.33. It doesn't matter, maybe we can now do it that way. So that we get 16 divided by 12, we get 1.333 megahertz. And also remember to take care of the units. So 1, then we get the reciprocal when we are obtaining the machine cycle. Get the reciprocal. So for the machine cycle, we are going to get the reciprocal of 1 all over 1.333, which is going to give us what we call 0.75 microseconds. And that one is the machine cycle for that particular system. Again, for 20, the same. So part C, for 20 megahertz, we are going to have 20 divided by 12, and that one will give us what we call 1.66 megahertz. So the reciprocal of that, 1 all over 1.66, should give us 0.60 microseconds. Again, take care of units, because megahertz usually means you divide, you multiply by 10 raised to power 6. Huh? So that is why in all cases you usually have the micro. Micro means that you multiply by 10 raised to power negative 6. So you should always take care of the units. So that is example 1. That is how we can always come up with, calculate the machine cycle. Example 2 is going to be a little bit illustrative, because now we are going to have calculate the machine cycle for 1, then after the machine cycle, then we are now going to make a reference to our instruction set, so that we can obtain the machine cycle from the instruction set and multiply it with the time that it takes for that particular instruction to be executed, and all that we will obtain. So we are going to look at example 2. So in example 2, number 2, you say for a 8051 system, for a 8051 system of 11.0592 megahertz, comma, find how long it takes to execute each of the following instructions, So there are several instructions here, like move R3, comma, that one, 55, decrement R3, C, decrement and jump if not 0, R2, target, D, we can talk of long jump, E, we can talk of short jump, F, we can talk of no operation, then G, we can talk of multiply AB. multiply AB. So these are the instructions that are in 8051. So what you are required to do is that you are going to go to your instruction set, look for the each and every instruction. Then in the instruction set, if you look at it, there is a column that is there for the machine cycles. So you are going to use that in order to get the amount of time that is required in order to execute a given instruction. So you are going to look at the time that is required to execute each and every instruction. But first of all, before you do that, you are supposed to calculate the machine cycle for this particular system, because you've been provided with the machine cycle for the system, with the crystal frequency. So just like the same, like in what we did in example one, so we have the same frequency as example one. So we are going to get the machine cycle. So we are going to get the machine cycle. So the first thing is that we are going to take 11.0592, then divide it by 12 or multiply by 1 over 12. Then from there, we are going to get what we had as 921.6 kilohertz. Then from there, we are going to get the machine cycle. The machine cycle is going to be given by 1 all over 921.6 kilowatts. Again, you have to take care of your units, because kilo means you multiply by 1,000. Then that one means that you are going to have 1.085 microseconds. So that is the time that it takes. Under this particular crystal frequency, it takes 1.085 in order to execute one machine cycle. So after that, we go to our instruction set for the 8051 microcontroller. Then we can now get the each and every instruction, then the machine cycle for every instruction. So maybe we can have a table here, can form a table here, and form a table here. That manner, so that we have that. So here we can have machine cycles, then here we can have time to execute. Time to execute. So looking at, if you could look at the instruction set, so we have move R3, move immediate figure of 55 into register R3. If you look at that instruction, we cannot have all those instructions in the instruction set, but you'll find that in this case, you have been given maybe something like move RN, then with that symbol, then given data, because this is a data. This one simply means that you are moving, this is an immediate movement, moving whatever is given under that instruction. Then you take it into that register. So in general, it will be represented as move RN hash data. So you are going to look at that machine cycle. If you look at your instruction set, then you'll find that it has got one machine cycle. So the time that it takes to execute, you are going to say that the one machine cycle times the time that we had already obtained, that is 1.085 microseconds, which is simply 1.085 microseconds. Then we can go to the next one, decrement R3 again. This one will be generally given as decrement RN. So if you look at that instruction, it has got one machine cycle. Again, it will be 1 times 1.085 microseconds, which is 1.085 microseconds. If you look at the instruction DJNZ R2 target, so again, you look at DJNZ RN, then maybe another figure given there, then this one usually has two machine cycles, so it will be 2 times 1.085 microseconds, which will give us what we say to be 2.17 microseconds. Then we can have the long jump. The long jump also has 2. If you look at it, the long jump has 2. So again, it will be 2 times 1.085 microseconds, which is equals to 2.17 microseconds. For the short jump, again, we have 2. This is going to be 2 times 1.085 microseconds, which is equals to 2.17 microseconds. Again, we can go to no operation. No operation, this one should be short jump. We can go to no operation. No operation as 1. So 1 times 1.085 microseconds, which is equals to 1.085 microseconds. Then we have this that has got 4 from the instruction set. Then that is going to be 4 times 1.085 microseconds, which is simply going to be 4.34 microseconds. So that is how you are supposed to obtain the time that is used in order to execute a given instruction. That is how to obtain the time that is used in order to give, in order to execute an instruction. So that one will give us a clear way on how we can now calculate the delay time, because that is going to be our next example here. So we are going to go look at a simple example on how to calculate time delay. It's going to be our last example. So if you talk of the delay calculation for 8051, it involves all the parts that we have talked about. So we were just looking at examples in order to introduce us on how to calculate this particular, the delay calculation for 8051. And a delay subroutine, the delay subroutine usually consists of 2 parts. One of them is setting the counter, and another one, a loop. A loop is now that particular part of instruction that is going to be done several times. So for us to understand this very well, most of the time delay is usually performed by the body loop, and this one is what we have in example 3. So let's look at example 3 in order to find how we can do this. So the question is find the size. Find the size of the delay in the following program. Of the delay in the following program. Of the delay in the following program. If the crystal frequency is, this example 3, if the crystal frequency is 11.0592 megahertz. So this is what we have. So we have move A, comma, that one 55H. Then this instruction tells you to load A with 55H. Load A with 55H. Then we can have maybe again a move P1, that is port 1, comma A. So you are moving that instruction into A. So you say issue value in register A to port 1. Issue value in register A to port 1. Then we have a call, that is absolute call, a call delay. So this one is, we are calling for the time delay. Then we can call it CPLA. That is, you complement register A, then SJMP, short jump again. Then you can say, keep doing this indefinitely. Keep doing this indefinitely. Keep doing this indefinitely. Then from there, we can call time delay. Then the delay, can have delay here, then move R3, comma, that one, 200, then this one you say load R3 into 200, load R3 with 200, load R3 with 200, then here, we can say decrement and jump if not zero, R3, then comma here, stay here until R3 becomes zero. Then you say stay here until R3 becomes zero, till R3 becomes zero. Return, that is return, that simply means return to caller. So basically that is the program that we are supposed to calculate the time delay for, and we are not going to get everything for the program. But rather, we are only going to look at where the time delay is. So you can see where the time delay instruction starts. We only have three things that we are going to, because we have been asked to find the size of the time delay, not the finding the size of the whole instruction. So you will only go to where this one is. Of course, this one's usually called the comments. The comments are always used when you are writing a program in order to illustrate what the program is supposed to do. So in each and every program usually have the comment, and of course that part, these are now the instructions. So if you are supposed to calculate the time delay, so for you to calculate the time delay, you don't need that part, because what you have been asked is the time delay. So what you will need is simply this part, but I'm not saying that in all cases that is what will happen. So that is what you will need. So we do the same thing that we did. We've been given the frequency, the crystal frequency of the system. Then from there, we are supposed to calculate the machine cycle. So therefore, we start by getting the machine cycle, which will be given by, the machine cycle will be given by 1 all over 11.0592 divided by 12, of which if we do that, we are going to get 1.085 microseconds, just like before. So there, we are dividing this one by that and then getting the reciprocal. So it is an easier way of doing. So it is 11 that all over that. So that is what we are going to do. Then from there now, we look at these three instructions that we have. We go to the instruction set and get their machine cycles, and then these machine cycles are what we are going to multiply by the time that we have in order to get the time delay. So in this case, we have the instruction here, we can have the instruction, then from here we can talk of the machine cycle. So that is what we are going to do. So you go to the instruction set that of 8051. Look at this particular instruction, then obtain the number of machine cycles that it has. So if you go to the UI instruction set, you will see that move RN hash data has got one machine cycle. Decrement and jump, if not zero, has two, and this one also has two. So these values have obtained from the instruction set. So if we do that, then in that case, we are now going to look at the value. We are going to multiply the value of that. So what does this instruction do? Before you do that, you're supposed to understand what the instruction is. So if you look at this properly, you'll see that it is a loop. The first thing that we are supposed to move to R3, it means that at the end of this instruction, R3 will be having a data of 200. Will be having a value of 200. Then the next instruction is increment and jump if not zero. So we have 200. So if it is not zero, you decrement to 199. If it is not zero, you decrement to 198. And then it's supposed to go that until it becomes zero. When it becomes zero, it is supposed to return to the program. This one is just some sort of, this type, particular time delay is just what we usually refer to as a subroutine. It is just a subroutine program. So after all that has happened, then it is supposed to do it that one time. So in actual sense, this instruction will be executed once. Then decrement and jump if not zero will be executed how many times? 200 times. Then again, this one will be one. So what we are simply saying is that the time delay will now be given by this one, the 200 that we have here, times 2, 200 times 2, plus this instruction will be executed once, the other instruction will be executed 2 times, plus 2, then the whole of this is supposed to be multiplied by 1.085 microseconds in order to give you the total value. So if you do that, you are going to get 437.255 microseconds. So you can change it to even seconds or whatever. It doesn't matter, but the unit will be very, very important. So I think those ones are the problems that maybe we can try and solve. Those are just three. Maybe you can do more. You can always find more of examples. Examples are not exhaustive, but if you want to look at maybe more examples, you can always go to EEES.education. And you will be able to see more examples and also some of these notes that will be helpful to you during your study of microcontrollers, especially introduction to microcontrollers.